raw as an athlete.
Including running non-stop, wait for this, from Eden on the south coast to the top of Kosciuszko in about 30 hours, wasn't it?
Exactly
41 hours. Was it 40 hours?
41.
And hardly stopping except to eat. An amazing feat. He's age 44, I blow them now. He's an established ultramarathon runner. He has completed over 50 ultramarathons and runs in minimal, the footwear that Jeanette Murray showed us, the skin footwear with her toes, he has eaten vegan since 1999 and raw vegan since 2005. He runs his body solely on raw fruits and veggies. As an educator, Grant manages the 80-10-10 certified lifestyle coach program developed by Dr. Douglas Graham. And Grant enjoys helping other people to be their best through education and support. He loves music and he loves life. He embraces novelties. He has actually fallen asleep while running, beat that. And he plans to run a 100 mile race when he turns 100. So that's 160 kilometres race in 56 years' time. Ladies and gentlemen, for his subject inspired to run over mountains, give a big hand to Grant Campbell.
Thank you, Roger. That was my whole talk.
Was not. I heard you for now.
Yeah, so I'm living a pretty inspired life. And through this talk, I hope to share where some of that inspiration comes from. One of my goals is to help you realize that it's actually easier to take good care of yourself. It's easier to be healthy rather than to be sick. It's not to be strict and disciplined and have all this willpower, because I certainly don't depend on those things. So I just want to probably try to get across that it's a simple lifestyle that I live. You can do it too. It's not hard. And there's a lot more about life, as I'm sure you're aware, than just food, and so I'll talk a little bit about that. Some of the growth, personal growth that I've experienced, particularly through ultramarathon running, which is a fascinating sport. I didn't realise what I was getting myself into when I got into it, but I'm sure hooked, because I've actually done more than 60 ultramarathons now. The count keeps rising, doesn't it? And my next one is on Sunday. This coming Sunday, 1 week from now, which is 100 kilometres just to the north of Newcastle. So somewhere between 10 and 12 hours I'll finish that one. All going well. So I was raised on a standard diet and was very, very shy growing up. I would never have done a talk like this when I was growing up. Not a chance. I was the shaken one when you had to speak in class or whatever. So I've come a long way, and diet and lifestyle has helped with that. But just as a catalyst, because when your nutritional needs are being met for starters, and your other needs like sleep and rest and human contact and all these other feeling fulfilled, then it gives you a stable base where you can do so much more with your life and pursue the passions that we talked about in the earlier meditation session that we did. And I encourage you all to pursue your passion. It's there's no valid reason not to. It's out there and we're all driven by these things. We might as well pursue your passion. I went vegetarian first in 1998, just overnight after hearing a friend just tell me a few things There's a friend I used to go rock climbing and canyoning with in the Blue Mountains. And he just told me about how animals, you know, being slaughtered and raised in with factory farming, how they end up with cancer. And of course, some of that ends up on the supermarket shelves and people end up eating that. And he wasn't trying to scare me, but that conversation just planted a seed. And I started, ever from that day, I not only went vegetarian overnight, but I started reading labels on food. I didn't have a clue about food before then. I ate whatever was put on my plate. My grandfather always taught me, finish what's on your plate. Sometimes he couldn't finish it, so he put that on my plate, so I had to finish that. It didn't seem fair, but I loved my grandfather. I went vegan 18 months later, having progressively learned more and more, like, oh, gelatin, oh, well, it's made from, it's an animal product, okay, I'll get rid of that. Every time I gave up an animal product, I felt better. Or I was indifferent. It's like, oh, I don't miss that, so why cause any cruelty to animals? Why take advantage of other life on the planet if I don't need to? But pretty much, as I gave up every animal product, I felt better. Dairy was a huge one. Snoring just like kind of disappeared overnight. What else happened? For anyone that saw the video, the documentary, they have a very funny snoring scene in that. By the way, the documentary is equally as good as what Janet described. It's really phenomenal. Exceeded all my expectations, so I strongly recommend to watch that documentary. 18 months after I went vegetarian, I was vegan. Even though I wasn't striving for veganism, I just realised one day that I was vegan. I was reading an article, and I was like, oh, that's what I do. And I formed some early on rules for myself that helped keep me a bit on the straight and narrow. Like, I didn't eat anything frozen, canned, or anything that had ingredients that had numbers, like all the preservatives and all the food additives, so anything with numbers. Or if anything had an ingredient that I didn't know what it was, I wasn't allowed to buy it. I wasn't allowed to eat it. So that forced me to research and learn all about all these things. And of course, all of those things aren't things you want to put in your body anyway, so that kept me safe from eating them until I learned about them. I remember when I first went vegan, the first week, I came across a book by Leslie Kenton called, I think it's called Raw Eating or something like that. It was a really interesting book, planted seeds about raw, eating raw. But it didn't tell you how to do it, it didn't seem practical, I didn't know anyone eating raw. And so it took me 6.5 years before I actually went raw vegan. And that was after hearing some of Dr. Douglas Graham's information, which you can see is all over the table over there. And that changed my life. I listened to this 12-hour audio program called Perfect Health Program, and then overnight just went raw vegan because I was inspired to, because I had the knowledge from coming across the information that I hadn't heard before, which all seemed like common sense. So I kind of felt silly that I hadn't thought about myself to eat fresh fruits and vegetables, which everyone knows as health foods, to the exclusion of everything else, except for some nuts and seeds occasionally. But so I went raw vegan, and relating this to my running, it was interesting, when I went vegan, that's when I started running like 5K once a week, then twice a week, then three times a week. If I ran more than three times a week, I'd start getting sore knees and sore ankles. And I thought that was just my body, it was not developed to that point or whatever. But I was like, wow, this, you know, vegan diet's amazing because I was doing so much more. So that was quite profound to me. But when I went raw vegan, oh my goodness, life changed. Like it went from black and white to color. I actually had this buzzing feeling here. Like, I don't read about chakras and third eye and all these things, but I felt a buzzing here for about a week when I went raw vegan. I was running, I was able to sprint for a longer distance before I would have to, like, before I would fail through too much lactic acid buildup or oxygen deficiency, whatever it is. So I could sprint further. And I could also just kind of, it was like I got endurance for free. I could suddenly just go for a 3-hour run and just be like, that was fun. It just, like, it was a dramatic change overnight. And Yeah, the food is hydrating, so fresh fruits and vegetables, everything you're eating is hydrating, so you're getting water from everything. So I don't really drink a lot of water generally. I'm drinking some now because speaking makes me thirsty. But a lot of days of the year I don't drink any water. Just get all my water from my food. For example, I did a 100-mile race along the Great North Walk, the trail from Newcastle to Sydney. It's a race called the Great North Walk Hundreds. It's my favourite. It's a very creaky part of the stage. It's my favourite race, which I did for the first 9 years of the race every year. And I was quite famous in that race because I actually didn't finish it in the first 7 years. The eighth and ninth year, I did really well. But every year I got further, and I always got at least 100 kilometres into the race. So it was always, it was still an amazing race. So it was never like I gave up easily. But for every year, there was a different reason. But the first year I finished that race, you're all curious what I ate, right? I had 18 kilograms of mango in 34 hours. That was heaven. Can you imagine? I had 2 heads of celery. I had 25 medjool dates, which isn't many over that distance, and water. That's all I put in my body. I didn't take any salt capsules that all the other ultra runners worry about. Salt is something that I don't put in my body. I think I put it into the category of, I'm not sure if it's pronounced pica or pica, but it's a condition where people like eat wallpaper or toilet paper and eat unnatural things like dirt or whatever, because salt's from the earth. It was never alive. It's an exception to everything else we eat. Everything else we eat was alive at some point, whether it was an animal or a plant. Hopefully from a plant. And when you eat salt, there's a hormone in your body called aldosterone, which the levels lower. So when you're eating salt in your diet, which means you throw off sodium and salt in your sweat and your urine more readily, like a waste product. Whereas when you don't consume salt, your aldosterone levels are higher, you get better at holding onto your sodium. So I can run long distances and not have to worry about salt. Whereas other ultra runners are all worried about hyponatremia, which is low sodium in the blood. Hypo meaning low, na for sodium, Na. Condition in the blood. So, because I don't eat salt in those races, I don't have to worry about the fluid retention that happens which actually makes you thirstier. If you were to just drink seawater, you would die of dehydration within 2 days. So by taking all the water away and just having the salt, I'm not sure that that's a smart idea. when seawater would dehydrate you and kill you within 2 days. But it tastes amazing, you know, so I understand the attraction to having salt. But fortunately, I got it out of my life and I don't miss it one piece. And like many things, there's a transition period where you step away from an old habit. And at first, you're thinking about it. It's on your mind. You're like, I really want XYZ. I really want that cigarette, or I really want that Subway sandwich, or I really want that Indian food, or I really want whatever it is. But if you can get through that period, it's so empowering. There are strategies for getting through tendencies to do things that you want to try to get out of your life. You can distract yourself. You can have short-term strategies. These strategies won't work long-term. Eventually you have to do things because you truly love and value doing them, and you acknowledge the rewards of doing it. But in the short term, you're maybe overcoming addiction, or the psychology of that, and perhaps even changing your environment, which could mean the people you're around, or sleep patterns, or whatever it is. But, I mean, I didn't have any disordered eating at all through my life. I just, like I said, I ate what I was raised on. Which was just like a meat and two veg kind of homemade dinners. didn't eat much. You know, it was rare to go and get takeaway food and such. I didn't have a lot of soft drink, and so it wasn't a lot of processed foods that people come unstuck with these days. You know, so we had these home cooked meals. But I had a lot of problems when I was growing up. I felt like I always thought of myself as healthy. When you ask people, like, how do you eat? They usually say, pretty good. But it's a wide spectrum of what people eat, right? And I don't judge people, but my judgment, you know, certain diets are not okay. It's like certain things that are obviously causing problems for people. So I was on a standard diet, and I would get chronic asthma to the point where I'd wonder where my next breath would come from. I remember sitting up for at least half the night on many occasions, just like right next to a window trying to get some fresh air, or unable to lie down because I just couldn't breathe, and just trying to just get that next breath in. And that was with a ventilator, asthma puffer thing. So, you know, it was a pretty big problem. And when I went raw vegan, that totally went away. As a vegan, you're still eating cooked food. I got asthma less, but occasionally. And certainly fitness also helped with asthma. When I was a teenager, when I would go through periods where I'd get fit, and then periods where I got unfit. The asthma would definitely lessen when I was fitter, when I just, whatever, to fix your respiratory system, and I guess more fitness means that system works better, and the foods that I was having in my diet that were irritating me and causing asthma didn't affect me as much when I was fitter. So when I finally went raw vegan, had all those things out of my diet that were harming me, no asthma. I used to get irritated. My skin used to get irritated whenever I rolled in grass. It would just get itchy, and if I got stung by a bee, I would have like huge welts, like hives, like big puffed up welts, like an anaphylactic response as well. And yeah, even mosquito bites. If I got bit by a mosquito, it would irritate me. I'd be so itchy, and I'd be scratching, and I ended up with a horrible scabby weeping kind of thing that would take weeks to heal and scar and stuff like that. So now I get bitten by mosquitoes, and firstly I feel the bite. I'm like, a mosquito's biting me. My instinct isn't kill, you know. I'm like aware of what's happening, and I have some control over what I'm doing. It's like, a mosquito's biting me. I know that's not the end of the world. And I'll usually like blow it off, or try to catch it and take it outside without squashing it, which can be tricky with mosquitoes. But I have done that successfully. Occasionally it's not successful, I don't like that. I take it to that level. Whereas if I can avoid causing harm to an ant, well, I'm happy to. I picked a salad 2 nights ago from my garden. My son's been growing fabulous vegetables in the garden for me, and it's really awesome. And there was an ant. It doesn't matter how much I check the leaves out there, when I get it inside, there's always something on the salad. So I took the ant back outside again, put it back where it should be, and came back in and continued my salad. I take time for these things, and I value that. And I think it's important to kind of have respect and reverence for all life. When I went raw vegan, running just started getting ridiculous. So I went raw vegan in 2005. I had done a little bit of dipping my big toe into ultras just before that. I'd run a race 35 kilometers through some valleys and mountains and valleys in the Blue Mountains of New South Wales, and loved it. It brought me to my knees. I remember climbing this 8 kilometer hill to finish a race, and I just staggered across the line. I was like, what just happened to me? Less than 5 minutes later, I was thinking, what can I do next? And I don't know. They say it's the same with childbirth, right? Like, have a baby, and they say, never again. And then they see the baby, and it's like, oh, it's so beautiful. The let's have another one. It's interesting. The pain gets forgotten, you remember the good things, and that's how I look back on ultras. I don't see it as suffering. I remember the beautiful things that happened. I love running in storms. I've run in storms and had trees falling over actually in front of me as I'm running, and that was remarkable. I love seeing nature at play. I really appreciate things like that. But I don't have a wish for death either, so I do take care in whatever I do. But, you know, I do things that a lot of other people don't allow themselves to do, I think. I think the reason is that I went through life holding myself back from a lot of things and didn't realize that it was me holding myself back. An example would be when I had young children. I was working at IBM. I worked in the corporate world for 15 years, by the way. And I would either be at work or at home, or I'd feel guilty. And, you know, that was just, I was putting that on myself. I felt like it was a responsibility. You know, I'm a parent and I'm, you know, the money maker of the family and all this sort of thing. But I never did anything for myself. Never at all, nothing. And I still enjoyed things. Like, it wasn't a miserable life, but I just realized, like, I never really, like, did anything for myself to the same level that I would do it for other people. When I realized that I was doing that to myself, life changed. I started doing things for myself, and it felt really good, and started doing the things that I really valued, which didn't mean neglecting other people. I still give to other people because I value that just as much as giving to myself. But if I don't give to myself, then I can't give as much to others, because it's not sustainable if you're neglecting your own needs. So, you know, I've come to a point where I really value the way I live and my lifestyle choices. Like, I'd rather miss a meal than to eat something that has something that I just don't want to eat. It's just as simple as that. I used to have these issues. I remember when I was working at IBM, and they'd have foods would be given to the team as a recognition. Like, they'd have some recognition event, and they'd give them meals or whatever. And there's sort of some sense of entitlement, because everyone else on your team that you worked hard on is being rewarded, but they're doing it with something that you don't value, something that you don't want. But there's still this sort of sense of entitlement that was lying there, that I felt like I should be getting something too. These days I wouldn't care about that. I don't think I have any sense of entitlement anymore. But I had to work through that. And when I went raw vegan, I started feeling more. I got clearer in my thoughts. And that really only happened while I was 100% raw vegan. It's just nothing else, like 99% raw, whatever. Like, it's not the same as being all raw in my experience. And I'm sure Janet and Alan would agree, and anyone else that's been 100% raw for a long time, with fresh fruits and vegetables. There's different ways to eat raw vegan. You know, a lot of the stereotypical kind of historic ways were to have a lot of fat and not eat much fruit, and I don't think that works well for humans. Our cells are fueled by sugars, and fruit is the best source of simple carbs, and it comes with this amazing package of nutrition that meets all of our needs. And combined with some vegetables, like particularly leafy greens, then I don't think there's any shortcomings in the diet. You can occasionally have some nuts and seeds, but like Alan and Janet, I don't take supplements, I don't take any of those kind of refined, processed things. I don't use oil, I don't use... Because oil is just fat with everything else refined away, right? Just liquid fat. So it's a really refined product. Doesn't matter if it's from avocados or from whatever. It's not good fat or bad fat. It's refined. It's a refined food. And good fat, bad fat, that sort of discussion. If you're having too much fat, it's too much fat. Doesn't really matter what source it's from. And an example of fat causing problems for people is type 2 diabetes, where the fat causes blood sugar to get stuck in your blood for too long, until it stays at a high level, because the fat coats everything, coats the insulin that's supposed to take the sugar out of the blood, coats the blood sugar, so the insulin can't kind of bind with the blood sugar. So your blood sugar will be high, and your brain will keep telling your pancreas to release insulin to take care of the high blood sugar problem, but it doesn't work because there's too much fat in the bloodstream. So you end up with too much insulin in the blood. And eventually when the fat starts to break down, then the insulin takes out too much blood sugar, so then you have a crash of blood sugar. That's the life of the type 2 diabetic, which is not a pleasant one. But through taking the excess fat out of the diet, that problem goes away. You don't need to become fruit phobic, as a lot of people have done over the years, because that's what a lot of the medical teachings were, and that's what people believed. The problem was the sugar, because they've got high blood sugar, so surely sugar is the problem. But sugar wasn't the problem, the fat is the problem. And anyone that I've seen, type 2 diabetes, that eats a simple diet of fresh fruits and vegetables without any garbage, let's say, to be polite, without any stuff added to it, their problem goes away. The type 2 diabetes just goes away. I haven't seen any exceptions to that. It can be within 3 days. Sometimes it can take up to a couple of months for some situations. I'm not sure exactly what's different in those situations. But there's a lot of people now that are actually getting people off type 2 diabetes with a fruit-based diet and low-fat diet. They also have exercise, because exercising before a meal actually opens up your cells, so they actually just accept sugar directly, can accept sugar directly without insulin, which wasn't really known until recently. I don't know when they discovered it, but it's sort of more modern information. They say that the information that's in textbooks is about 10 years behind what they know. People like Bruce Lipton, the information that he's that do with genetics and how the environment of the cell affects genes, that stuff, you know, it's just barely making its way into textbooks now. Right? It's not. So the information becomes known, and they have to do some big study, and then they have to, someone releases some book maybe, and it gets well known, and then the information maybe makes its way into curriculums, and then they train teachers to teach it in the universities, and then whatever, it takes about 10 years. So it's cool that we have the internet, we can do our own research and shortcut that process these days and start to get into some forward thinking with what's really known. So I said I don't have salt during races, but I do have celery, usually, if a race is 100 miles or more, which is 161 kilometers or more, which I do as often as I can. And that's because it tastes really good. And I think the reason it tastes really good is because I get some extra minerals, some for electrolytes, for whatever reason. I must be losing some during the race somehow, through sweat. As long as I'm hydrated, I'm sweating the whole time that I'm running. Last year was a good year for me. I ran my fastest 5K time ever of my life, and I ran the best long distance race, like ultra distance race, that I've ever run in my life. So in August, I ran across England, which was 225 kilometres, 140 miles. And that took me just under 35 hours. And out of the 15 crazy people that entered that race, it was a low-key race. But everyone that entered that race was well qualified. There was one guy there that has a reputation for running the longest ultras that he can find. And then at the finish, he turns around and runs back to the start. And that race that I did with him, we crossed the line together, actually, equal seventh out of the 15 people. But every race that he had done in the 7 months of that year prior to that were longer than that 225-kilometre race we did. So my hat goes off to people like that. It's just astonishing. And to people that run around Australia. So that was an amazing race because it was the first time I'd run that far. Because when I ran from Eden to the top of Mount Kosciuszko, which took 6 hours longer to run, which was a few years earlier, So I'm still improving, which is it's encouraging. Hopefully that doesn't ever run out. I just keep improving, right?
Grant, what did you eat on that run, the Kosciuszko run?
On that run, things that come to mind were I had unripe mangoes that I couldn't eat because I bought them a few days before and they looked like they were going to be ripe and they guaranteed they'd be ripe and they just didn't come on. They're R2E2 mangoes and they just stayed firm and it wasn't working. I tried so I had to go to a backup plan of celery and dates. I would have a length of celery, 15 centimetres or 12, 10 to 15 centimetres of celery, and stuff it, and I'd get my support crew, which is my brother-in-law, to stuff it with medjool dates that had already had the pits taken out. And then he would make two of those and then put one on top of the other and I'd eat it like a sub. A celery date sub, you ever had one of those? So it was a burst of sugar and a burst of minerals, and whatever, all the other good things in greens.
How many dates on the whole trip then, say?
Oh, I'd say there's 120 dates in a box, 5 kilogram box. I would probably eat we probably had half the box in that race, something like that, half a box of dates.
Wow.
A couple of kilograms of dates.
And how much celery?
You guys do that all the time, right? Celery, usually 1 to 2 heads in a race, typically 1 head. But sometimes I feel like 2 heads, and that depends on the condition. Yeah,
a head, a bunch,
yeah. Yep. Yeah, they say 2 heads are better than 1, but sometimes 1 is okay. It depends on the race, so the question was, do I have to carry all this with me? And by the way, you can ask questions whenever you like. Some races are self-supported, and other races, sometimes I run around a 400-metre track, like an Olympic track, and I can self-support. I just put a chair there with a box of fruit, and every time I come past, I've got the option of eating. I've had a few bottles of water, and I'm good for the race. But other races, like when I ran from Gosford train station to the Opera House via the old Pacific Highway, going through what's that place called? Down now, after you come, before you get into Tarramurra, just it goes way down. It's a beautiful scenic.
Gorge?
Not Gorge. Not Gorge, that's a good guess. Brooklyn. It's near Brooklyn. It's past, it's Sydney way, sorry, Brooklyn.
Barawa?
Barawa. I'll think of it. It's a national park kind of area, like you drive in.
Koringa.
Koringa.
Koringa
National Park.
Koringa National Park, yeah, but what's the, yeah. Bob and Head. Thank you very much. You got a prize. There's got to be a prize over there for you somewhere. So Bob and Head, huge downhill climb and then back up again. So that was pretty epic. A lot of ups and downs, literally. And that's self-supported. So that was 11 hours where I had to carry everything I needed, except for water. But water wasn't very available either. There's long stretches of bushland and there was just nothing, no water available for lots of sections. So during that race, I have the option to carry more water than I can comfortably run with, which could be at risk of injuring myself. If I'm running with too much weight, then I could get some sort of mechanical breakdown. Or I carry less water than I need and go thirsty for a while. And that's the option I went with, and it's a bit rough, but I made it. I really appreciated the water when I finally got some. But I've through ultra running, sorry, there was a question, Marilyn? Yeah.
Do you eat while you're running?
Yeah, I do eat while I'm running, preferably. When I did this race, the Cascade Crest 100 mile race near Seattle, through the mountains near Seattle, takes it about 30 miles of the Pacific Crest Trail. I did that 19 days after running across England too. That was a race where I felt really strong because I'd just run across England, so I guess I was residual fitness from that. And I was just running up hills like they were flat, And it was amazing. Like, I just couldn't, I'd never experienced feeling that way running up hills before. And when I went through the checkpoints, the aid stations in that, event, I just grabbed watermelon, grabbed grapes. They had like great fruit selection during that race at aid stations. And there was an aid station about every 7 kilometres. So I only had to carry a small bottle of water, and I'd just pick up a handful of grapes and just throw them in my mouth, and then grab a few pieces of watermelon and then just go. And I might walk for a little while, but I can run and eat. Just sometimes you drop things, that's the only inconvenience. Yes?
So do you avoid avocado, or would you have a bit?
No, I enjoyed the avocado at lunchtime. Do I avoid avocado? During races, yes. It doesn't work to my favour. There's a book called Slow Burn, which talks about eating fat and they talk about getting into a fat-based metabolism, and I know there is some truth to that, but I think it's a bit silly. I think that nothing can be being fueled by fruit in a system where you don't have fat in the way of that kind of getting into the cells quickly. So, and when you eat, when you're running, when you're exercising, your body produces more of an enzyme that helps with that sugar uptake. So, and for like 1 to 2 hours after exercise, you still produce more of that enzyme. So you can actually uptake twice as much sugar, like in the same amount of time. So you can recover faster from burning calories if you eat immediately after activity or during activity.
Say, well, you know, some vitamins are fat soluble, and
there's fat soluble vitamins A, D, E, and K, and so you need fat. Like, there's no question that you need fat, but there's fat in lettuce, there's fat in lots of food. So the question becomes, are you eating enough fat? And the World Health Organization, unless they've changed their stance, says you need 3% as a minimum of protein. Of your total calorie intake, and the same for fat. If you're getting like at least 3%, and if you're eating whole foods, so not refined foods, not like protein powder or whatever, but if you're eating whole foods like we had for lunch, except for the cooked foods, so I would argue that they've had some of the water taken out by cooking them and there's been some changes of nutrients, but everything else was whole. And if you're eating whole food, you can't not eat enough, even the cooked food, you can't not get enough protein or enough fat. There are essential fatty acids, which are important, the omega-3s and the omega-6s, which affect inflammation response, which is good for me for running, so I want that inflammation response to work very well. But a range of fruits and vegetables has a good balance of omega-3s and omega-6s. It doesn't have too much omega-6, like what most people eat from processed foods, which causes them to have problems where they perhaps bruise easily. Omega-3 and 6 balance is to do with clotting and unclotting of blood as well. It's one of the factors involved. But yeah, fruits and vegetables, it ticks every box, as long as you're not having too much fat. And the unrefined, like the fresh, you want fresh and you want whole. The gold standard of food, whole, fresh, ripe, raw, organic plants. Carrots? Are you saying, are they good? Are you asking you want my opinion, are they good? Or are they a good source? Thanks, Roger. I never recommend supplements other than to get you out of an immediate crisis. So for an emergency response, I would say, you know, like if I chop my arm off, I'm going to go to the hospital and please sew it back on, get the neurosurgeon to do whatever they can. Put me under, give me whatever drugs to stop the pain or whatever, whatever they have to do, I'm at their mercy. But as far as just being on supplements for the rest of your life, I think it's a far better option to change your lifestyle so you don't need to be taking supplements. I figure if we need to take supplements in order to survive on this planet, I think we've overstayed our welcome. You know what I mean? Like, it's like we can't live without taking B12 shots. Like, someone tell me there's something wrong with that. Like, I don't like discourage people from taking B12 shots or whatever. If that's how they want to deal with it, that's fine. But just my personal thing is like, that's really disappointing if I have to take that just to survive. Like, I'd rather find out what's wrong and find a better way, or perhaps remember the way that before, when people didn't seem to have to take B12 shots because they didn't exist. Aging, I think people age themselves more if their lifestyle isn't so amazing, right? So age isn't just about how old you are. You can have two people that are 80 years old, and one could be eating 1,600 calories a day and not exercising, or 1,200 calories a day and not exercising, and the other person could still be agile, like Jack LaLanne or something, until he's 94, still doing 2 hours of like strenuous weightlifting and stuff until he died. So age, things happen to our body as we age. I think aging is more like environmental, the circumstances that our body go through individually. So I think it's individualized where your body is at. Some people can't even eat fruit, like their body just can't handle it. Because it's so damaged in certain ways. So some people have to have liquid food. Like, there's a lot of different, some people don't absorb, some people have had their stomach cut out to just be at some little, you know, gastric bypass surgery, which one of my friends had. And he has to take supplements because he doesn't have all the absorption that normally takes, that happens in a normal gut, like in a normal digestive tract. So I think, I'm not sure how to answer the question other than that. So it's individualized, and I think lifestyle choices to prevent supplementation needs is always going to be a winner. I know somebody earlier, one of the speakers, recommended that they don't recommend superfoods. I'm not sure who it was. But I also don't recommend superfoods. The things that people talk about are superfoods. It was Doug, because he talked about fruits and vegetables being superfoods, which I agree with.
Yeah,
superfoods. If you insert a couple of letters, it can say stupid foods. But it's not a kind word. So superfoods, I think the fallacy in superfoods is that people are going for more of something, like more is better in every scenario, and they maybe don't need more. Like, I think Doug also mentioned that a lot of diseases are caused by excess. In fact, I think most disease is caused by excess, but we worry about insufficiencies and take excess just in case. So, anyway, so fruits and vegetables diet is effortless. I just buy in bulk. I can buy it anywhere in the world. When I was eating a cooked vegan diet and traveling, I struggled to find, like in Japan, I couldn't ask whether something was egg noodle or not or whatever. It was really hard to eat as a vegan. But as a raw vegan, it's easy. Fruits and vegetables are available everywhere except for maybe trekking in Nepal or something. So it's really easy. If you buy in bulk, it's cheap and affordable. And it's way, way cheaper to be healthy. It's really expensive and uncomfortable to be sick. And pursuing that avenue of eating to the degree that you're willing, fresh fruits and vegetables, it will open up so much more to your life, to grow in so many ways, to feel more, to connect with others, and you'll start. I mean, you'll become a biophiliac, a lover of nature. It just, all these things just happen just through having your body's needs met. I think naturally, we are like a pure state of love, and I think that's the default state between people, and but things get in the way of that. And I think if we go back to a diet of fruits and vegetables, then it kind of takes down some of those barriers and enables us to be our best selves. certainly in my experience, there's other ways to grow as an individual through yoga or whatever, but I really believe that fruits and vegetables as a solid base is the best way, to the best platform to take you forward to grow in all the other ways that matter as much or more than what you put in your mouth. Yeah. I do other exercise. I mean, I do pretty strenuous gardening sometimes. I'll just get in and just rip out like fields of grass or whatever. I like to do things manually. And I do other training. Like I'll do squats and lunges and all that sort of stuff and bodyweight exercise. I do deadlifting a few times a year. It helps my running. But not a few times a year, like for a few months of the year. But mostly I run. And I enjoy running, all different types of running. So short and long, but I love trails and I love nature. It's the best aspects of running. But any running, I love the camaraderie, just running around tracks and stuff. Question, Richard.
The overland track in Tasmania. Have you run that?
I know they. I haven't done the overland track in Tasmania. I haven't run Cradle Mountain. It's on my list.
Yeah.
I have a long list of races I'd love to do. Unfortunately, unless I get sponsored by somebody, I can't afford to do all the races I want to do. It's, they're like, a lot of the races I do are like $350 just to enter.
Yeah.